Brain is the most mysterious thing in the entire human body. On the one hand, it's still being studied by thousands of scientists trying to uncover all its secrets. On the other, this is the only human organ that is responsible for something immaterial, the mind. Everyone has a brain, but some people are lacking the mind. These double standards don't apply to the liver, kidney, or even heart. As for the brain, it coordinates the body and allows us to wonder about stupid questions like what is good and what is bad. And despite its indisputable importance, humanity still knocks on the tightly sealed doors of this neural creation. Even the science studying the physiological processes in the brain appeared somewhat recently, just in the last century. On top of that, psychological theories about our intellectual ability change from century to century. Here, we will shed some light on another human mystery. At what age is a person the smartest? First, answer a simple question. How would you define a smart person? I don't know all the answers, but I'm sure they'll fit into one of the following. Smart is someone who reads a lot. Smart is someone who received a good education. Smart is someone who knows a lot. Smart is someone who knows how to design things. Smart is someone who thinks logically. Smart is someone who thinks outside the box. Smart is someone who can learn. I could add a few more options, but I think you get the point that mind, intelligence, and being smart are all very complex concepts. And if we bring philosophers and psychologists in the comments, then it's going to turn into a never-ending holy war where everyone will be pointing at their favorite author. Personally, I'm fond of the ideas of Raymond Cattell, who divides intelligence into fluid and crystallized. Despite its name, fluid intelligence isn't always about solving a problem quickly. It is activated when a person needs to solve a problem that lies beyond their accumulated knowledge. So, when a new situation arises, a person uses all their analytical and logical skills and is able to think abstractly, or as marketers like to call it, outside the box, and find a solution to a problem they have never seen before. For example, let's imagine that you find yourself in a strange city and you need to get to the other end of it. The route is not familiar to you, and you have no idea how you got there in the first place. So you use your phone navigator, look at the signs, and ask the locals. That is, solving the problem. Along the way, you learn your route so that later you do not waste time on the additional search. Fluid intelligence is your mental flexibility. It's needed to identify a problem and choose strategies to deal with it. One might say it's like solving a puzzle. These are the so-called soft skills, which are often mentioned by employers. But let's get back to the intelligence, or rather to its second part. Crystallized intelligence goes hand in hand with its fluid counterpart. From its name, it's clear that this thing is formed over many years. It's based on life experience, acquired skills, and knowledge. However, it's not to be confused with long-term memory. Crystallized intelligence takes useful data from long-term memory. By the way, the use of words and their understanding is also its responsibility. Here's another example of how it all works together. Let's say you're solving an equation at an exam. It activates short-term memory, keeping your attention on the task. Fluid intelligence determines what exactly is in front of you. So you move things around, rearrange them, analyze, and then it dawns on you that, first, you are at the exam. Second, you've got to solve an equation. Third, it's a quadratic one. And fourth, just don't be afraid. Your fluid intelligence happily reports to its crystallized buddy, saying, "Come on, bro, you do some work too." And now the crystallized intelligence begins to look for a proper formula to solve a specific problem, pulling it out of long-term memory. So, when you repeat in your head the mantra, I studied it," you're sort of pushing your crystallized intelligence so that it quickly finds the answer in the spacious storage rooms of long-term memory. That's how our brain operates during problem-solving in general, and of course, linear problems aren't the only ones we solve. The brain is much more diverse than what's presented here, and it has been confirmed by scientists. So, at what age does a person reach their peak of mental abilities? To Two psychologists from MIT and Massachusetts Hospital conducted a series of experiments to determine how the brain ages. And while everything was as expected with physical abilities, which start to diminish after 30, as does our entire body, when it comes to the brain, everything turned out to be much more interesting. The first experiment involved 2,500 people aged 16 to 89 years. Participants were given 23 tasks ranging from defining words and general knowledge to arranging pictures to make a story. Other experiments used data from research sites. Thanks to the internet, about 10,000 people took part in this endeavor. It turned out that in different periods, a person reaches the peaks of their mental abilities in different areas. So, let's rephrase the question a little. When is a person the smartest? But here we must clarify, smartest at what? Here are the results. 18 to 19 years old. At this age, the speed of information processing is at its maximum. It's the time between receiving information, visual or speech, and its interpretation and response. After 20 years, the processing speed begins to decline. 25 years old. It's the heyday of short-term memory. This is a kind of temporary storage that allows you to keep an operational amount of information in your head until it's either forgotten as unnecessary or transferred into long-term memory. For the next 10 years, the capacity of this storage remains at its maximum, but after 35 years, it becomes increasingly difficult to keep large amounts of data in your head. 30 years old. At this age, our memory for faces is at its best. After that age, when we meet a person, we'll be struggling to remember where we saw them before. 40 to 50 years old. This is a time for the blossoming of our superpower, the ability to look into the soul of another person. Scientists call this emotional perception. This skill is measured very simply. Volunteers are given a photo of a person's eyes and asked to determine what feelings they are experiencing: fear, joy, anxiety, bewilderment. Young people are much worse at reading the eyes. Interestingly, we retain this skill without a loss for up to 60 years. 60 years old. Did you think that at this moment the brain is about to go to rest? Not even close. At this age, our vocabulary reaches its maximum size. Moreover, with each passing generation, the lexical maximum is found at all later ages. Scientists associate this with the fact that physical labor is gradually being replaced by mental labor, and people have to use their brains more and more. In addition, they receive better education and have wider access to information. 60 to 70 years old. This is the heyday of crystallized intelligence. The ability to make decisions using accumulated life experience, knowledge about people, skills, and long-term memory. It turned out that after 30 and even 40 years old, the brain continues to break records in some areas. At any given age, you're getting better at some things, you're getting worse at some other things, and you're at a plateau at some other things. There's probably not one age at which you'll peak on most things, much less all of them. Probably such heterogeneity of the peaks of intelligence is due to the fact that a person faces different problems at different times. And I think it's a great reason to be optimistic. Hit that like button and subscribe to the channel. And I'm Bonyright.